Hello, everybody. Welcome to our North Shore Reads event. My name is Sarah Ormland, and I'm a librarian with the North Vancouver District Public Library. I'm joined tonight by my colleagues Kendra Sakamoto and Julie Becker from the West Vancouver Memorial Library. Our North Vancouver City Library colleague CJ Pentland could not be here tonight, but we want to thank him for his work on this event. We're quite sure there are people joining us from all across North America and probably across the world. And while we recognize that we are all in different places this evening, we would like to acknowledge that for those of us here on the North Shore of Vancouver, this event is taking place on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh, and Musqueam First Nations. If you are uncertain as to which ancestral territory you live on, we encourage you to visit whose.land to learn more about the traditional lands on which you reside. Giving a territorial acknowledgement like this is a very small part of reconciliation, but it is an important reminder to we as libraries and as individuals that we must continue to take meaningful action towards reconciliation. On September 30th, many of us here on the North Shore showed up to take part in being a wall of support when Tsleil-Waututh Nation did its 8.5 kilometer pilgrimage from St. Paul's Residential School to their home reserve. There are always opportunities for us to find ways to show up, listen, learn, and support. And your library is a great place for you to learn about ways to participate in reconciliation action. We have the great honor tonight to have a traditional welcome from Elder Carleen Thomas of Tsleil-Waututh Nation. Thank you so much for being here, Elder Thomas, and we turn it over to you.
Hi, Chikat Sarah. O siem ni siaya, ai tenishkolowin, kutsi kutsnala ihui, antha ansakalot, antha mana santhalya I kwet slahot siam, antha imeth kwef ansakalot, I kwet slahot siam. Iqueth squestamotuch, iqueth halat, hai sepka, amit sepwood wheelum, e swokhotmish, e slawato tamath. So, what I said to you in the very teeny tiny bit of my language that I know called Hunkmeetnam or Downriver Hulkamalam, I said, my respected friends, the feelings I have inside are really good. I feel really good to be with you here tonight. And in our cultural ways, I introduce myself to you with my ancestral name. I carry the name Ansakalot. It doesn't have any meaning, but what's so special about it is that after many generations, my late paternal grandmother was able to recapture that name. She found that name that it was lost for generations. And when I became a young woman, she shared that name with me. Also in our cultural ways, I shared a little bit of my family tree. We do that for a number of reasons, but the most important is that it informs you, the audience, that I know who I am. I know where I come from. And as a wamokta, as a grandmother, I carry that responsibility a lot more dearly these days. So my parents are Deanna George and the late hereditary chief, Ernie George, or Iggy, as his friends called him. Both sets of my grandparents have passed on. My paternal grandparents are the late hereditary chief John L. George and Lillian, or Dolly George, as she was known to her friends. For a real long time, I didn't acknowledge my mother's parents, my maternal grandparents. And I guess as I became closer to becoming a granny myself, I had to pause and reflect on that, because both my grannies were such integral pieces, parts of my growing up years, my formative years. And what I came to realize was that, you know, I'm a pretty colonized person. You see, back in the day when Canada was being built and the colonizers were taking all the Indians and sticking us on reserves and drawing borders on those reserves and sticking labels on those reserves, they separated us. They divided us. In effect, they set us against each other. We were in competition for lands and resources. And so, in an act of decolonizing myself and reconciling my relationship with my sister nations, the Musqueam and the Squamish, it's with great honor and respect that I acknowledge my maternal grandfather as Stanislaus Joseph, Stan Joseph, from the Squamish Nation. And my grandmother comes from, my grandmother was Caroline Nee Thomas Nee Joseph Nee Trimble. And she comes from the Snanaimo, the Nanaimo people, and Kinkolith, Niskut people up in the beautiful Nass Valley. And you couldn't see, but I was raising my hands. In Coast Salish territories, it's a gesture of welcome. Hi, Sapka, Amitsa Putwilam, thanking you all, welcoming you all to the homelands and waters of the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh people. And I echo Sarah's sentiments earlier, you know, please recognize the Indigenous peoples from where, whose lands you're on right now at this current moment. I'm really looking forward to this evening, and I will pass it back to you, Sarah, I think. Take care, everyone. Hey, Owish.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We really appreciate you sharing your words with us, your family with us, your journey of reconciliation with yourself. And we really feel honored to be welcomed. I feel it very deeply. It's not just a welcome. It's an act of generosity, and we really, really appreciate it. And also, we really appreciate you talking about the impact of your elders for yourself and you thinking about yourself as an elder. And I'm sure that theme will be coming up in the conversation as it has shown up in Ivan's book. So welcome again, everyone, to our second annual North Shore Reads. The purpose of North Shore Reads is to connect people across our North Shore communities by the shared experience of reading the same book. The book, in this case, is Kara by Ivan Coyote. And it seemed like a natural and obvious choice because we, as the committee, loved how it gives readers a chance to reflect on some of the effects of the pandemic on ourselves and our relationships, but more importantly, how it gives readers a window into the vulnerabilities of others' lives and the grace and compassion we can all choose to have for each other. We also thought it was a total no-brainer to invite back CBC's Shelagh Rogers, both because, let's face it, she's amazing, but also because it is no secret that she and Ivan are pals and have a lovely rapport with each other. So without further ado, we welcome Ivan Coyote and Shelagh Rogers to do what they do best, to talk and let us in on their thoughts, perspectives, and stories. Welcome, Shelagh and Ivan.
Sarah, thank you so much. And I also want to say Heichke CM to Elder Carleen Thomas. I'm thrilled that she talked about grandparents because I know they're going to come up. Ivan, so happy to see you. I have a sort of intro to the book. Would you like me to kind of do that?
Absolutely, Shelagh. That would be great. Thank you.
Okay. All right. First of all, I would like to acknowledge the territory I'm speaking to you from, which is Lekwungen territory, and the unceded territories of the Songhees and Esquimalt nations. And I'm very grateful to be living where I live and appreciate the welcome. And I also really grieve the time that I didn't think about whose land I was on. And that was a very big part of my life. So I'm grateful to the teachings of Elder Carleen Thomas and also what you said, Sarah, that it's so much more than a land acknowledgement. Well, through books and through years of performances, Ivan, you have formed this deep, forged, a deep connection with your readers, your audience, and then you're a performing artist. It's your lifeblood. and it grinds to a halt. So what is a performing artist to do? There's a beautiful quote. You refer to yourself as a professional suitcase packer, a world-class map reader, a finely tuned leaving machine. And then you had to become a staying machine. But what you did was to pull out letters and Facebook messages and notes and emails from over your decades of touring and publishing, speaking, delivering amazing stories, and started to answer them. And because you did have the time, and you said you answered each letter with a story that the original letter shook loose from your rib cage. And I love that. You also said that you had time to drink a second coffee in the morning in your bare feet, which I also love. But these messages and your replies become care of letters, connections, and cures. I don't know where you are. I know you're in Ontario, but welcome. It's so lovely to see you again.
Thank you so much, Sheila. It's so great to see you. I am joining you from the traditional territories of the Anishinaabeg, the Haudenosaunee, the Ottawandaron, and the Lenapewak peoples, known in the settler imagination as London, Ontario. And I've been thinking a lot about how, you know, I'm driving down Elgin Street and Wellington Street, and I think the colonizers, we came here and then we couldn't even make up new names.
Right.
And I'm in London, Ontario, where I'm the current Alice Munro Chair in Creativity at the University of Western Ontario, which was a huge godsend getting this gig. I think I got the call in the first week of May 2020, just when Sarah and I were, my partner at the time, when we were, she was a singer-songwriter and a touring artist as well, when we were kind of going, okay, like, how are we gonna keep the roof over it? How are we gonna pay the bills? How are we gonna keep the wolf off the door? Because it all had just crumpled so fast, as everybody knows. And I by no means have the worst story, but it was a scary time. And then I got this gig. So I'm grateful to the University of Western Ontario for this beautiful roof that's over my head right now. And I got that gig, and as soon as I knew there was going to be some work coming in, that freed my brain up from worrying about how I was going to not just pay my bills, but I was helping take care of my father as well, who was struggling with, at that point, the middle days of dementia. He's a little bit farther down that highway now. And so I'm very grateful. And I come from Whitehorse, Yukon, which is Kwinlan Dun and Tahan Kachin Council territory. And I live part-time in Atlin, BC, Atlin, which means big water in the traditional territories of the Taku River Tlingit. And I wanted to thank Carleen for that beautiful welcome. And it got me, of course, it doesn't take much, as you know, Sheila, to get me thinking about my grandparents. So my grandmother's name was, on my father's side, was Patricia Rita. She was born Leaper. Her last name was Cumming after she married my grandfather. She was Irish and a little bit Irish. And he was Scottish and Irish on my dad's side. And then on my grandma Flo's side, my maternal grandmother, as Florence Amelia Mary Dawes, born Florence Lawless, which I always liked that surname. And she was Irish and Roma and a little bit Jewish, we found out later. And she married a Scottish Canadian guy by the name of Albert Dawes.
Wow.
I don't know what Albert's maiden name was. Anyway.
It's so interesting. I've been thinking a lot about grandparents as well, and great grandparents. And I always appreciate the teaching about grandparents and making sure, you know, you have four, if you're lucky, and remembering each one of them. And what I didn't know when I was growing up in Ottawa on Algonquin territory, that my dad was Métis. And it was something he kept very, very hidden. And now I've started to get to know my relatives and my ancestors too, which is really cool. And one day you and I are going to talk nothing but grandparents and ancestors, because okay. Like, yeah, it's just a lot of fun.
My grandma Flo was, she told everybody she was English. Because she grew up in North London, and she told everybody she was English until I started. I mean, we had heard about the Roma blood just from, but she did not. She would not. It wasn't until like 2005, 2006 that she finally like completely fessed up, and that was because they were instructed to lie about who they were when the Nazis were coming to power in Germany, just, you know, leading up to the Second World War, because she was Roma, and we know how the fascists felt about the Roma, and she was Jewish and she was Irish in England. Like, none of those things she wants. So she just literally, and my grandma, my Irish grandma, used to give her the gears about being the grand colonizer, eh? Because she just took it. And it wasn't until well into her 90s or well into her late 80s that she actually started to really talk about who she really was. I guess she finally felt safe enough, mm-hmm. maybe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, Ivan, the book. First of all, the honor of speaking to you again about it is fantastic, because I have so many questions, and the book came to mean so much more to me over the pandemic and the time I had COVID. I found it was a real comfort. It was a real solace. I felt through your book and through your stories and the letter writers, the power of connection, even though we had to be alone and we had to isolate ourselves, especially when, like, we tested positive. And I've been thinking a lot about it. It's this collection of wonderful letters and responses, and I love the call and response. There's so much of your life in it. Is it also a memoir?
I don't know. You know, I've never been much interested in those genre classifications. So I haven't. I love the question. Is it a memoir? I guess of a sort. It was an homage to the letter itself, you know, and I learned that again from my grandma Pat. She was a fantastic letter writer. In fact, one of my things on my to-do list is in storage in Vancouver is a box full of her letters to her sister Shelagh, her letters to my uncle Jack, many of which contain early, early stories about me, as far back as 3 years old, scathing letters she wrote. She was a scathing, scathing letter writer. And she sometimes would make carbon copies.
Yeah.
On her typewriter.
Yeah.
She would take the carbon
copy. Really hard. Yeah.
Yeah. And she wrote the last letter to Chatelaine magazine, complaining and announcing to them that she was doing away with her subscription because they were getting rid of the letters to the editor section of Chatelaine magazine. And she was outraged, and she thought that any periodical that didn't have a means of hearing feedback from its readers was no kind of periodical, I believe, quote unquote. So in as much as a good letter is a memoir of at least a short memoir capturing a chapter of a person's life, you know, that, I mean, that's what they used to do. They would catch up by letter, right?
Yeah.
Somebody, one reviewer said that they thought it was one long letter to my father, in essence. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure about that. You know, it's interesting what people will glean or take from a book that might not have been in the very forefront of my mind when I was writing it. But yeah.
Oh, readers will bring their lives to it and vice versa and absorb it into their rib cages as well.
Yeah.
And I also just have to settle a bet right now.
Okay.
I had lunch with the amazing writer Monique Gray Smith, Scottish Cree Lakota. And so I said, I have the honor, and you know, I saw Ivan just right before the pandemic lockdown, and we had an excellent hug.
We did.
And Monique said, well, I think mine was closer to it, and it was, you're going to tell me it was, because she ran into you in an airport.
So did
she have the best last hug?
Well, I think they were both excellent hugs. I'm just going to say that. Okay. So
thanks.
It's not about quality of hug here, but I hugged you, and I know for a fact it was February 26th, 2020. And I know for many reasons. One, it comes up in the book. Two, it was my grandmother Patricia's, would have been her 100th birthday.
Yeah.
It was also the day that there was much magic afoot that night. I still have that little glass heart that you gave me too, by the way. It's in my bag of trinkets that I pack with me in all my travels, which are still many. Mm-hmm. And it was the day that I pitched a book deal to Jared Bland, who ended up being the editor of this book. Wow. And there was many, and as you know, that night at the Nanaimo Public North District branch of the Nanaimo Public Library, There ended up being, I think five of the letters came from people who were in the room that night.
Yeah, that was incredible. Yeah.
And that was a fluke, or there was some connection. I mean, there was the letter that I answered to Adri about her daughter, Kate, letter number two. She was there in the room, but she had written me before, but I didn't know that the woman I met that night was the same woman from the letter. Bernie's partner had written me, who wrote the letter about top surgery. They had written me that morning, and that same day. It was even Jared, when we were going through it, I said, I don't want to sound like a hippie, but have you noticed, like, there's too many coincidences in this book for it to be a coincidence? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he agreed that there was much magic afoot in all the connections. Like, there's a math connection too. There's a mathematician, there's a statistician, there's a trans kid who wants to be a mathematician. I have a weird Rain Man brain for numbers. Nobody, I don't talk about that much, but I do. I have like a weird, I don't know. I hardly ever use it. Yeah, so I hugged Monique Gray Smith on March 10th, 2020. I flew to from Vancouver to Toronto, from Toronto to London, or maybe Sarah picked me up. Mm-hmm. And March 12th, 2020 was when I was there to go do a couple of gigs in St. Catharines, all of which were canceled on that Friday the 13th. March 13th, 2020. So Monique Gray Smith was the last hug I had before, except for from Sarah, of course, before we went into that lockdown. Yeah.
I owe her 20 bucks.
You owe 20 bucks? Okay. Yeah. And I don't think I got to hug you in Seychelles, so I haven't hugged you yet since then.
Yeah.
And I haven't hugged Monique. So now we get to see who gets the which one of you I get to hug first.
Oh, I thought it was going to be the quality of hug. Okay, well.
No, they're both going to be exceptional hugs. I don't know how, like, those hugs that for people that you have not seen since 2020,
oh, yeah.
There's nothing like them.
There really isn't. there's, you know, we start running into people now, and it's not like the pandemic is over. We know that. And, but people will say, how was your pandemic? As though, how was your vacation? Right? It's so weird. It's just so strange. But for you, I mean, I know you were able to get to these letters and write responses, but as a performing, what do you call yourself? A writer, performer? No, that's not it. You have a very beautiful title, and it will come back to me. But how not doing that, what was that like?
It was multi-layered for me, to be honest with you. February of 2020, like when I saw you, I didn't even know how burnt out I was. I had just done, so it was kind of, so what happened was the Surrey School District was having a lot of problem with kind of gender-based and anti-trans and anti-queer bullying in their school system. It's a very, very big school district. Usually when I do school shows, the individual school funds it from either their PAC funds or, you know, their guest speakers, or sometimes as a EDI initiative or anti-bullying work. Sometimes they have a storytelling component in their curriculum, or they bring me in to speak with the SOGI club or the queer students union, or, you know, like that. Right. So, but what happened in January, February of 2020 was that I had a friend who was on the sort of EDI committee for the whole school district, and she got a big chunk of funding. So to cover it for the schools. So she said, I remember them saying, you know, it'll probably be about maybe 18, 20 school shows. We're not going to force any schools to bring the trans storyteller in, of course, but, you know, they can sign up voluntarily, and we're expecting maybe half of them. Well, every single school in the school district, I think it was 42 schools. Some of them had 3,600 kids and they only could fit 800 in the, so they would book me for 3 a day. And so I did, I think it was 42 school shows in like 6 weeks or something like that. And like sometimes 3 a day. And I had said, like, I can only do 4 days out of the week, especially if I'm doing multiple shows and driving in between and traffic. And you know, they said, well, if you're already at the school, maybe you could do 4 that day to make up. So, you know, I had to spend this money before the end of the fiscal year, and I was going to be on tour for all of March, right, as you know. And so I was going to be out east. So I just did all these school shows, and it was, so up until the fall of 2019, I did a pink shirt school show. Like, kind of the message was like, don't be an asshole. And a lot of trans content came out of the Q&A, and the kids would ask me, what pronoun do you use? And have you had top surgery? And does your grandma still love you? And that kind of stuff. But that would come in the Q&A. But after many, many years of school administrators and librarians and English teachers and social justice class teachers saying, you know, could you please, please, please do a more, like, we need the tools, we need to have the conversations about bathrooms, and we need to do trans 101 and pronouns, and could you please? So I rewrote the show, still trying to be, like, you still have to ultimately connect to 800 teenagers in a gymnasium on a Friday afternoon. Like, it is not meant for the faint of heart, right? And it's the hardest work I've ever done. And so I wrote this, like, specifically trans show, and the backlash was immediate, and it was terrifying. And I got doxxed online by an organized right-wing free speech. Their cover photo on their Instagram page was Brett Kavanaugh. Just, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. And they put my address online, and then the kids themselves, most of them, of course, 99.999% of them were fantastic, but I got followed out to my car by two little Jordan Peterson fans. I thought I was going to get gay bashed in the parking lot of the high school I'd just done an anti-bullying show at. A kid did a Hitler salute in a auditorium of 450 kids because I was telling a grandmother story. And I was telling the story of how my grandmother lied about who she was to protect herself because there was a dangerous man, I said, coming to power. Does anyone know in Germany just before the Second World War, who would that be? And one of the kids said Hitler, and another kid stood up and did the full on like see Kyle thing. And then the worst part was that none of the other kids would tell on who he was. He was a rich kid whose daddy was a lawyer, and it was awful. And, they peed all over a gender neutral bathroom right across from the gymnasium. Like it just went on and on and on. So to be honest with you, the first 6 months I was doing some rest and repair. Yeah. And I didn't realize how burnt out and how I think traumatized I was. I just carried it with me little by little by little, I guess how you do, you know? And so the first 6, 7, 8 months, I can't say I didn't miss the road because I'll always miss the road, but I needed to be off it. I needed that time. It was a time of stillness for me. I had planted so many gardens and so many flowers and so many shrubs that I had never been able to be around long enough to fully watch like blossom and bud and blossom and die and wilt, and I hadn't been able to watch that beautiful life cycle, because
yeah.
I was always, you know, I was always packing the suitcase and coming back from somewhere else. So and I just don't think the road's ever gonna feel the same, like something that gets taken away and you get back. I feel like you return to it in a different way. And I think all of us are different. You know, I'm really searching out ways to be smarter and to stay home longer. And that might be a factor of I'm 3 years older now too, right? And I guess part of my healing was realizing how burnt out I was. And I don't want to do that to myself, to the environment, to our beautiful Mother Earth, you know? I don't want to take 120 flights in a year, you know, it's not sustainable. Yeah. And when we have these kind of things, and of course this is not, but it also is, there's 182 participants. Hi, everybody. Yeah, welcome.
Yeah.
I wish I could know where they're all from. Maybe our hosts will tell us. It's accessible, you know. I'm wearing track pants right now. You don't know that. And and none of us are having to get on airplanes, and we've got closed captioned, and you know, I know it's not the same as a live event, but it is a different thing, and it is to be celebrated and fostered, and can be, you know, can be done with grace and good lighting and good cameras. And you know, I got a little something here going on. What?
There's two of them. I realized my lighting is done by a complete radio person, me. And so there's like all these weird shadows going across. I've got 8 eyebrows. If you know,
no, you're lovely.
No, but we do have our first question, Ivan, and it's perfect. It's a question about how you feel being back to your intense travel schedule and show schedule. Maybe it's not as intense, but there's another part to the question, which is how do you avoid burnout now? And I would just like to say at this point, please, as your questions come in while we're talking, I'm happy. I'm not going to store them up in a little nut house for the end. I'm not a squirrel. And so as they come in, it would be wonderful to bring you, the viewer, the attendee, into the conversation. So this first is an anonymous attendee and how you avoid burnout now and how it feels to be sort of getting back into it.
Okay. I will never return to touring to the same kind of intensity as I did pre-pandemic, for many, many reasons. One is that the economic reality is so vastly different. I mean, hotels have doubled. Flights are, I would say, 60% more. Gas is more expensive. Good luck getting a rental car. When I tried to get a rental car to go to Tsleil-Waututh last time we saw each other, I think they wanted $1,600 or $1,700 for 5 days for a little compact rental car. Luckily, Jane Davidson knew a person and who knew a guy who knew someone who owned a thing and, you know, got me, we got a better deal. But it's just not going to be feasible in the same way. And what do I do? I'm changed on a fundamental level. I'm not the same person. I've broken up with the city. I'm moving back to, I'm here in London until end of next semester. And then I'm going back up to the Yukon. I don't know what I'm going to do with my place. I've got a subletter in there right now in Vancouver. I may sell it. I'm letting myself get to the end of this gig, and I've got the person who's renting my place right now is in there till August 1st, I think it is. I'll decide then. I've given myself, you know, that time to think about it. I'm going to be living most of my time in the Yukon and Atlin. Atlin's just over the Yukon BC border, 42 kilometers. Yeah. It's 100 kilometers away from a cell phone signal. I'm fine with that. It has spotty internet at best. I'm not so fine with that. I'll probably be driving into town to my mom's place to do gigs like this. I spend a lot of time in the summers, the last three, well, not the summer of 2020, I was in Ontario, but 2021 last summer, and 2019 as well, before the pandemic, on 3 little acres in Atlin. And speaking of squirrels, did you know that squirrels change their tone of voice when there's a predator on the property?
No.
So I spent the summer of 2021 listening to a mama squirrel and two babies that she had echolocate with each other all the time. And then every couple of weeks or so, my carpenter friend would come with his three-legged dog, Gimli. And as soon as Gimli got out of the truck, the squirrels would change their tone of voice. And it was the mama squirrel telling the babies to be cautious. And
you had the time to notice that.
Yeah.
That's a lovely thing.
Those things are important to me. So I'm going to be very much more mindful of how much time I spend on the road and whether or not I have to be there physically. And I still want to be there physically for some shows, for sure. I imagine I'll be at this for a while, but I've lowered my sugar intake quite substantially. I started skipping rope. I had to hang up the skipping rope for a while, but we started skipping rope in the very, very early days of the pandemic. I now have a bit of a foot injury, so skipping rope is hard on the body. On if you're older and you have, you know, a little junk in the trunk, I have a foot injury. So, but I do a lot more. I operate at a slower pace, and I'm good with that. I'm still like, you know, compared to some people, I'm sure there's people out there going, Ivan Coyote at a slower pace. I don't think so. But to me, I know I'm operating at a slower pace. And I'm looking at some passive income sources like a Substack and selling access to a pre-recorded show that people, that so school shows. I think my school show days might be done. Yeah. I've performed for over 650,000 middle and grade school, middle school and high school kids on 5 continents now. And it's storytelling on the edge. You know, sometimes I would go to festivals and there'd be like a lovely, lovely writer, just a lovely person, great author, great books. And they're like, oh, I'm thinking about getting into doing some shows in schools. And I hear that you do a lot of that. And, you know, would you like to, you have any advice? And I would just be like, honey, it would be like throwing you to the lions. You do not have. And I wouldn't do that to you. It takes a certain kind of performer to get in front of 800. Grade 11s are the worst. Well, grade 8s are the worst, let's be honest. But, you know, half of them with earbuds. You've got 45 seconds for them to decide whether or not you're a dork or not. And anyone over the age of 18 is a dork anyways. And, you know, luckily, I would just take my long sleeve shirt off and they'd go, hang on, whoa, what? What's going on here, you know? But it was really hard work. I'm proud of the work I did. Yeah. But and I think if I remove the school shows, which are a grind and hard and in auditoriums for people who are not consenting in all the ways that, you know, like doing a theater show where everybody wants to come, you know, as opposed to like they're making us go to a auditorium for a lecture where there's a speaker. What is it this time? Crystal meth, teenage pregnancy? Oh, trans, I don't know, some gay thing, you know?
But you know, we've got a question. I'm gonna slip this right in because it's so apropos.
Okay.
From Nancy Masterman, who says, first of all, thank you for doing all those school presentations. Do you feel they made a difference?
Oh, I know they made a difference. I mean, I did them for 20 years. So I literally have performed for the children of people I performed for, right? And I mean, look at care of how many of those letters are people, how many letters have I gotten? I mean, there's no question that I did work that was had some value. I stood up in front of 650,000 kids. So let's say if we go with a fairly conservative estimate of 10%, we're talking about 65,000 queer or trans youth. That if at the very least, I might not have, you know, I might not have like, you know, they might not have liked it, but at the very least I was up there. I was unapologetic. I was unashamed and I answered their questions and I provided some sort of representation that I certainly never had access to, right. You know, I mean, it's a true story and I've told it many times, but it doesn't make it any less true. I went to the Whitehorse Public Library in 1982. Now keep in mind, my grandma Flo was a bookbinder there. So I was terrified of getting busted for this. So I went in and I asked the librarian for like books on sharks, giraffes, outer space, Caligula, spontaneous human combustion and homosexuality. And I just put that, just snuck it in. And the librarian, whom I knew and who knew my grandmother, came back, you know, and said, well, spontaneous human combustion, that's over in the magazine index. You're going to have to look that up. You know where space is. I know you know where sharks are. I was always at the library because my gran worked in the back room binding, fixing books, right? Yeah, yeah. And then she was like, this is all I have on homosexuality. And it was the well of loneliness. And the main character,
despair. Yeah.
Oh yeah, the main character, yeah. You know, there wasn't the language for it, but I would say is non-binary or trans and dies in the end. Like that, it actually dies before the end. And it was, wow. You know, it was not an uplifting. I wouldn't recommend it for any struggling queer youth, you know. And she knew that. She knew that when she gave it to me and she apologized that it was the only text she had, right? Mm. And I mean, meeting a queer, you know, there was a letter carrier that everybody knew. And I literally used to like, you know, watch her. I worked where one of the places I worked downtown when I was 14, 15, she was the letter carrier. And I literally used to like stop and watch her. It wasn't a sexual thing. She was much older than me, but it was like a sighting. It was like a sighting, you know? And so, I mean, I guess I think I know I did some good work, even just showing up and letting someone like those kids know that they weren't the only gay in the village. And I went to some villages, let me tell you. It wasn't a small town that, you know, they asked me, I went.
Yeah. Well, and there's a letter in care of from Kate, who's a bookseller in, I think, in Vancouver. Yep. Vancouver Island, who grew up in Halifax. And understanding that queer and trans kids can now see themselves in books, in stories, is like, you got to watch Billy Crystal faking being gay, right? There just wasn't a lot out there.
You know, the first trans character I ever saw was in The Crying Game.
Oh yeah.
And you know, even the man who loved her like vomited when he you know, yeah, found out who she really was. Like, and that was considered representation because we existed in it. You know, people weren't, you know, we didn't have the luxury of being too picky about how we were represented, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and I mean, that's the exciting thing about the whole literary scene right now. And the last, I would say, I don't know. I was just talking to the lovely Zoe Whittle about this. I had her as a guest on my Active Voice series last semester. I think I had her in March. I think she was a guest in March, if I'm not mistaken. And she was saying, remember we used to go to the festivals and there would be like, if there was another queer person at all. And she said, you could literally fit all the queer authors, much less trans, queer authors would fit at one table. You know, and they would stick us all together, like, you know, we would taint the heterosexual events at the festival or whatever. They would be like spiking the punch or like, you know, whatever it was, spice night. They would stick us all together. And there was eight of us, you know, and now there's so many, I can't keep up with it. I can't keep up with it. And I would say the similar thing with indigenous authors and writers. Sure. And, you know, like you look at the nonfiction bestsellers, there's been multiple times in the last 2 years where it's been just 10
for sure.
Indigenous writers, you know, and it's not the indigenous writers top 10 list. This is the
this
top
is
10
the,
list. So.
And there's Bob Joseph Jr. who wrote what he called a curious little book called 21 Things You May Not Know About the Indian Act. It has been on the best 4 years. 4 years.
Look at our
Michelle
buddy Sheree.
Good. Look at Sheree. Absolutely. Absolutely.
David A. Robertson, he's hitting hat tricks.
Right out. The theory of crows in the top 10. Right. And then Michelle Good, who's like number one or number two. For the last
swept the awards.
So it's an incredibly it's a really exciting time. It just feels so good. And even when I started doing the next chapter 15 years ago, I've seen incredible, just the surge. Let's celebrate the surges. The surges are fantastic. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go to the questions because our time's flying. I knew this would happen. I really wanted to, there's a comment. Thanks for coming to Tsleil-Waututh this summer. We love you.
Thank you. I love Tsleil-Waututh.
What are you doing with your musical talent? I remember you playing with Queer as Funk.
Oh yeah. I was thinking to myself, so both my baritone saxophones and my tenor are all in Atlin in the basement. Wow. And the nice thing about that property is there's not a lot of places you can play the baritone saxophone and not disturb your neighbors. Let's be honest. And that is one of them. And I'm going to, so when I get home next April, I want to start, or join, a band. I even put on Twitter the other day. I really love the bottom end and I love the sound, the bottom end. But I've always skewed low. Like I like the bass guitar, I like the sousaphone, I like the tuba, I like the bass clarinet, I like the bassoon, I like the French horn.
Sousaphone,
right?
Let's hear it for the sousaphone. Yeah.
So I was like, I want to start a band that's all lower end instruments. Have a baritone as a singer, a submissive baritone, and call it the bottom ends. know. I was like, we do heavy metal covers, obviously.
There was, okay, that I know that some people who are attending will remember Morningside program on CBC Radio with Peter Zosky. He had a low off. He had like a contest about with three guys, how low could they sing?
Yeah.
And Tom Jackson was one of them. Gary Relier, who's a baritone. Why do I remember this? And I don't know where my keys are. Okay. And then there was another guy. Oh God. Anyway, it was a rock singer. It was hilarious.
Yeah.
Because they would keep going lower and lower until they almost couldn't breathe. But
my favorite low note in the whole world of a lot of favorite low notes is Aretha Franklin. It's on One Lord, One Baptism, One Faith. It's Aretha Franklin, Mavis Staples, the Staples Singers, and Jesse Jackson in Atlanta, Georgia. Have you ever heard that album?
No.
Oh, I'm going to play it for you next time we hang out. And Jesse Jackson does an introduction, and then please welcome one of the greatest joys of our lives, Sister Mavis Staples, Sister Aretha Franklin. And so these two, I mean, OG powerhouse women are coming to the stage, and they start. We met on a Mississippi road one night, and yeah, and Aretha, she hits this low note that is, my hair standing up on my arms right now thinking about it. She's such a genius, right? Yeah. And it's so beautiful. And then I remember hearing her. No, I must have seen her because I can remember what she did with her mouth. Somebody said, Aretha, the average human voice has a average, even a trained singer, human voice has a vocal range of 3 octaves. Yeah. I've heard it said that yours is over 4. Is that true, Aretha? And she goes, 5.
Love. That's so good. Wow. Beautiful. Okay. There are a few more questions coming in, Ivan. And you're making me laugh and cry at the same time, which is what you do.
The coyote 1-2, that's what I call that.
Yeah, it's a good one. It's a good one. The 1-2 paw, right? Quick little question. When you're touring now, do you find yourself sending more written letters or postcards?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I've always loved letters. I've always loved postcards. I've always loved snail mail. Shout out to my friend Carly Boyce in Toronto. She's such a great letter writer and note writer and gift sender. And all of those things they're so great. Like, who doesn't love getting a letter? You know, an email's great, don't get me wrong. Text is great too. I love that. I'd love a DM. I'm not against any of those things, but man, I just love a letter. So yeah, I do. And I've collecting postcards. And you know, every book I've ever done, with the exception of Care Of, I think, I had Arsenal print up a postcard of the cover. And a real postcard, like with the space on the back to write on and stuff, like not just an ad postcard, right? Like a real postcard. And absolutely, for sure. Yep.
Here's a question from Jen Ham. Ivan, your stories have impacted me deeply as a nurse, an educator, and most importantly, as a mother and a person. Thank you truly from my heart for your teachings. When I read Care Of, I was so struck by your vulnerability and generosity in the sharing of yourself. How do you discern how much to share? This is a great question. How much to share and what to hold sacred? And do you ever have sharing remorse?
Well, let's unpack the word vulnerable just for a second. Because if you look at the dictionary definition of the word vulnerable, it means open to attack. And there's other meanings, but that's the first definition. And people say that a lot, like, thank you for being so vulnerable. I could never do it. And what they're saying is they could never do that, that they would feel open to attack. I don't feel that. on stage. I want to qualify that. On stage is a position, is a place of, it's a sacred place for me. I try to bring my best self onto that stage as much as I am humanly capable of, whatever minor annoyance or petty grievance I might be holding in my head, I try to erase it. I try to scatter it from my heart before I step up there. And to me, being on stage, connecting with other people on an emotional level, that the right story told by the right person at the right time in the right place in the right way can do, is the most powerful thing I've ever seen. We've all witnessed it. We've all been a part of that cycle of, or that circle, yeah, of connection. And to be able to take someone to a place emotionally is, it's a hugely powerful thing. I don't find it vulnerable at all. What I struggle with, and where I am vulnerable in the negative connotation of that word, is at the book signing table. That's when people will step across my boundaries. I've been groped. I've been sexually harassed at book signing tables, or those spaces. I've had, you know, people say inappropriate things, touch me, hug me when I was not comfortable with that. You know, one of the things I'm hoping that we take out of the, we carry with us is like, I'm down with this six foot rule. And this is something that I started modeling a lot, you know, when I was doing school shows with youth, when they would want to take pictures, right? I would say, is it okay if I put my hand on your shoulder? And they would all go, yeah, of course. They want to, you know, but my thing is being more conscious of those things. So actually up on stage in my so-called vulnerable space is not vulnerable to me. It's extremely powerful place and it holds within it when done right, and with done the right kind of humility and the right kind of compassion and love. And I know this doesn't, it seems counterintuitive to some people, but you have to listen while you're talking up there. And you have to listen with your hair follicles and your pores of your skin and your ears and your eyes and your heart. And I don't think I have sharing remorse. I think my mother has sharing remorse on my part. I think she wishes there were certain things I wouldn't talk about. I am fond of telling my mother, who I love, who hopefully you'll meet one day, when I bring you to the Yukon, which we'll talk about my plans for that, because it's going to be so great. But what I tell my mother is, you know, nobody ever won an award writing a book that didn't piss off their mother. Like, that just never happened.
Yeah, there it is. Right.
I hope that answers the question asker's question.
Jen. Great question, Jen. Thanks. And there are a couple of, I'm keeping my eye on the clock because I want to tell everyone who's tuned in, Ivan's going to read. And I think that is going to be great. So I want to make sure that we've got enough space for that. Interesting question. Marnie Rice. I tuned in live online for the book launch of Care Of. On stage, you made a joke about the Yukon internet, and soon after, the connection to the theater was lost. When you settle in Atlin, are you worried that the Yukon internet holds grudges? That could be a quick yes or no.
I did literally, yeah. Because we had been rehearsing that thing, because it was complicated. We had a team of people in Toronto. We had the Penguin Random House folks. We had, I think, 17 of the letter writers present in the Zoom call. We had the Zoom call projected on the screen behind me so I could physically turn around and talk to them. Like, we had a big, massive thing with one little, and off it, and it goes, and we went down for, I think it was 11 and a half minutes. And that internet connection never actually came up again. Mm-hmm. What Josh did, the technical director at the Yukon Art Center, was he remembered that during Arctic Winter Games, like 4 years before, they had put in a second internet line, and he literally ran to the storeroom somewhere and got a really long internet cable and ran up to some office and ran it through the lobby and down and into the control room and plugged us and got us back up sort of half-assedly going. And we got back online, and Jared, of course, was there hosting in Toronto. And so, and then Atlin is even sketchier because I have satellite Wi-Fi there. So it can go down because it's too snowy, too foggy, too cloudy, and even too windy. Mm-hmm. So I guess I hate to admit it, but I'm waiting for Elon Musk to get his Starlink up. And,
he's one of the
it's going to change tonight, things actually. For the North.
He's hearing you right now. I'm pretty sure he's got a question lined okay. up in the Q&A. Okay. There's some very beautiful comments, which I'm going to suggest to the wonderful North Shore organizers. They capture somehow.
And send to me.
And send to you, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's great. Donnie writes, do you miss working with your hands? Would you like to go back to carpentry?
Back to carpentry. I'm doing Writers Fest and on Thursday and a couple gigs on Friday for a union, and I'm heading back up to the Yukon Saturday morning, and I'm hoping to be I'm gonna finish up my vapor barrier on Monday. So I don't have to miss carpentry, and I've got so much work to do. I'll be back at it. And if this whole storyteller thing, I worked a couple of days as a carpenter last summer. We were about to do something wrong, and I said, "Hold on, we forgot to factor in like the decking into our." And she's like, "Yeah, you're right." We just spoke. I said, "Not bad for a writer, hey?" She said, "Not bad for a carpenter." And so she, she hired me for a couple of days here and there. Mm. And which I was super chuffed about. And then I got actually hired as an electrician, which was my other trade. So I don't have to miss working with my hands because I haven't even lost my Allison from this summer yet. Yeah.
Okay. This is where things get tough for me as the moderator, because I'm looking at my little clock and there's 3 minutes to the time.
But you know what? I have to tell a story.
Okay.
I have to tell a very important story. Okay. And then hopefully maybe I'll cut my reading down and we can fit in some time for some extra questions. Okay.
Okay. I'm sitting down. What's your story about you?
Okay. So my dad had a stroke and fell and went into care starting in July 13th. And we finally got a placement in long-term care. But before that, he was living in my house he built, sold. I bought back. Long story. Anyway, my house, but he was living in it. I get back in April. And he was, I think, depressed and had dementia and was not staying on top of the cleaning. Let's just say that. And I had asked him not to smoke in the house, but he had been smoking in the house. So I spent 3 days just scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing. And I was scrubbing the filthy, disgusting toilet. And he kept coming in, and I had gloves on and I had rubber boots on. And he kept coming in and bugging me while I was cleaning the toilet, right? And, the TV's not working, the cable's not working. I said, I know you always switch the input. I'll come and fix it in a second. Just give me a second. Yeah, because I have something. And I got a bit snippy with him. In my defense, I had been cleaning his house with him just staring at me and then telling me what I was doing wrong, but not helping me. So my fuse was a little bit, maybe a bit. And I snipped at him. And I said, as soon as I'm finished scrubbing your off the wall, I'll be and your pee off the floor, then I'll be right out there to help you with your television. He was like, sure, that's your problem, right? And it was the end of 4 years of elder care, and I did my best to stay patient with the same questions over and over again, but I think I was tired, my knees were hurting, and I just snapped and I said, Do you think I don't have better things to do with my time than clean your toilet? Like, seriously, you know, I am the author of 13 books. I've been nominated for the Governor General's Award. You know, Sheila Rogers one time called me a national treasure. And he's standing in the doorway and he goes, oh, and I should warn anyone who's not this, I'm trying to stay true to what actually happened, but there is some language. So if you're offended by the F word, might be a good time to go have a pee or something or get yourself a snack. But, so I said, Sheila Rogers one time called me a national treasure. I'm still on my knees in this pee, right? And he's standing in the doorway and he goes, who's fucking Sheila Rogers? And I go, from the fucking CBC, Dad. Jesus. And he goes, what's the CBC?
Oh, man. I love your dad.
I started laughing so hard. And I immediately like scrabbled for my cell phone. I was trying to get it out of the pocket. I was wearing like a painter suit because it was a hazmat situation, right? So I'm digging around trying to get my cell phone. What are you going to do with that? He says, you know, He says, there's no cell service here. I said, I know, I'm just getting a number out of it. I'm going to call someone. Who are you going to call? He says, I said, I'm going to call fucking Sheila Rogers. And then I did. I called you from the landline, but you didn't pick up.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
You probably didn't wonder who the hell was calling you from Atlin, BC on the landline.
Probably. Anyway. That's a great story.
I've been waiting for months to tell you that story.
I'm so happy to hear it. And I may have to just like exit and have a pee myself. That was just awesome. Thank you. Story time.
Let's do this reading.
Let's do this.
And this is, so this was one, I think if I'm not mistaken, this was one of the oldest letters that I had sat on. And it was written on March, I received it on March 17th, 2011. Mm. And if I'm not mistaken, it was an email. Hello, Ivan. I attended your lecture last night. It was so wonderful. Quite distinguished. Oh, I it was the distinguished lecture. I was the writer in residence at the University of Winnipeg. Quite distinguished in my humble estimation. I really appreciate your perspective on growing up working class. Your story is very close to mine. My father was a storyteller. My favorite memories of my father are of him sitting around the campfire telling a story with a look of joy on his face and remembering some past humorous event. In some way, many storytellers seem to share an intonation of voice, a way of speaking. So when you speak, it reminds me of him. I'm also reminded of him when you tell stories about your father, the beauty of their gruff masculinity and the vulnerability that's there under the surface. It makes me so happy to hear you tell stories about him, even the short little comments about his thoughts and advice. It invariably makes me tear up, but since I am in a public place and it doesn't make much sense to others as to why I'm crying, I gulp back my tears. But when I read your stories about your dad, I sob like a baby. Speaking of my father in the past tense suggests he's dead, but he's not. He and my mom live in Moorland, Moorhead, Minnesota, across the river from Fargo, North Dakota, in the same house I grew up in. But for over 2 years, they haven't spoken to me and have responded to my emails with only a line of hope you are well. I came out to them when I was 16. I made my father cry, the only time in my life I ever saw him cry, not even at his parents' deaths. And I went on to date men and to marry a wonderful man whom I am still close friends with. At the end of my marriage 2 years ago, I came out to my parents again. They explained that they would continue to see and speak to me if I never talked about that and never brought any of those people to their home. Despite missing them, I chose not to hide myself. Why am I telling you this? I sort of wonder myself, but I've felt a great desire to tell you about this for a while, but I feel so starstruck that I cannot bring myself to talk to you. Also, I'd likely cry and not be able to say anything. I want to share my gratitude for what a wonderful gift you give me with the stories you write and tell about your father and family. It's a smidge of my own. It helps me remember that which I actively avoid thinking about due to my sadness and disappointment. So thank you, Ivan Coyote, for allowing me to be with you and your dad, allowing me to be with my own. So that was March 17th, which is my sister's birthday, 2011. And I finally wrote Dear Angela back July 29th, 2020. Dear Angela, I want to thank you again for your email. I can see from my email history that I wrote you a short response thanking you for your letter 4 days after I received your original email way back in 2011. It's probably going to be weird hearing back from me now, very nearly 9.5 years later. But I always meant to write you a true and proper response, so here I am. I talked to my dad today. I called him just before I sat down to write to you. Have you ever heard that song Mercy Now by Mary Goche? It's the first verse of that song that always reaches right into my chest and squeezes so hard. My father could use a little mercy now. I won't sing the whole thing because I picked the wrong key, but the fruits of his labor fall and rot slowly on the ground. His work is almost over. It won't be long, and he won't be around. I love my father, and he could use some mercy now. I was driving north in my old truck the first time I really listened to those lyrics, the Alaska Highway. I've lost count of how many times I've spent 4 days alone on that road, a mug full of coffee between my thighs and a sad song on the stereo, and the road stretched out like a dusty zipper through all of those spruce and pine trees. I'm always either on my way to see my family or on my way back to the big city and processing my visit with them. And my dad lives in a little town called Atlin, about 200 kilometers south of Whitehorse, just over the Yukon-BC border. And every time I turn left off the road to Whitehorse and then left and left again into his willow-lined driveway, I hear Mary Goche's lyrics in my head. The fruits of his labors fall and rot slowly on the ground. I can picture his little house right now. He never finished painting the railing on the deck. The lawn hasn't been mowed since I did it last fall before I left. His boat is still in the garage, its engine sitting in pieces on a tarp on the concrete floor of his shop, even though it's almost August now. He's sitting in his chair on the corner of the wraparound deck, smoking a cigarette. He will wave when I drive up and park, but he won't get up. His feet hurt, and so does his back. I spent all of last summer there. He and I were supposed to work together, fixing up his place, finishing the sauna he started the previous fall, and building a little cabin out in the tree behind his place for me and Sarah. We had big plans, but the red wine and the depression got to him before I could, and he spent most of the summer smoking on that deck. I remember one morning when I came into his house from my little travel trailer to put on some coffee and make oatmeal. My dad had the television on, but the sound turned right down. He was sitting on the couch wearing the same clothes he'd had on the day before, watching me with watery eyes as I moved around his kitchen. He sighed and stared at the rug on the floor in front of the couch. Told me he was sorry he hadn't been any help with stuff around the place lately. I just haven't been myself. Ever since Pat died, he confessed. I know it's been 3 years now, and I should just get the fuck over it and get on with my life, but I can't seem to do that. I walked over and took his empty coffee cup from the end table and refilled it, dropped in 2 sugar cubes, and passed it to him. Dad, I told him softly. Pat died 6 years ago. Not 3. Anyway, I just read your letter again, and I won't pretend that I can understand at all what it must be like to be so disconnected from your parents, and I'm sorry for the pain that this brings you. I'm so glad hearing my stories about my dad helps you with that sadness, even just a little. I'm not sure if the truth of him and I will bring you any comfort either, but I feel compelled for some reason to tell you that my relationship with my father is by far the most painful and complicated one in my life. Bar none, no contest, and since forever. I know he lies to me about how much he's drinking, I know he lies to me about whether or not he drank before he drove that long and winding highway from Whitehorse back to Atlin alone. I'm not even sure anymore why I ask him these kind of questions. I've prayed for him to get or stay sober for well over 30 years now. Ever since him and my mom divorced and the booze really took the wheel in his life. If he was a happy or even a happier drunk, I think I could let it go for the most part. But he is not. My sober father is funny and talented and creative and hardworking and charismatic. He loves dogs and talking to strangers in the grocery store and cooking and fishing and building boats. My drunk father is cynical, mistrusting, paranoid. He's angry, guilty, unemployed, and depressed. He loves nothing. But mostly, he is just so sad. I'm not sure what would be worse, to be honest, not talking to him at all and wondering if he is okay, or talking to him every Saturday like I do and knowing for certain that he is not. I've never been one to quantify pain. I don't think sadness can be measured. I read your letter again, and this time I learned that sometimes I tell the good stories about my father to strangers at shows so that I can remember him telling a joke and teaching me to tie the right knot in my fishing line. I choose the stories I tell about him so that I can remember him younger and handsome and laughing. I tell good stories so that those are the words that ring out louder in the room than my heartbreak and my disappointment do. 9.5 years. Is a long time to wait for a letter to come. I think if I had written you back properly way back then, this might be a very different letter. 9 years ago, my dad's wife was still working in town at the auto parts place. She was about to retire, and we didn't know anything about the cancer in her throat or her lungs or her brain. 9 years ago, I didn't have any gray hair yet, and I hadn't been married or divorced. 9 years ago, my father's boat was still tied up at the dock in that big lake, all ready for the weekend to come, and he mowed the lawn once a week all summer. 9 years ago, you hadn't really talked to your parents for 2 years. I would love to hear back from you about how things are with your parents now, if things have shifted or grown over. I don't think that the guy who wrote that time heals all wounds had a dad anything like yours. Or mine. I hope these last 9 years have brought you a little more peace in your heart. I hope you have found and held on to some good stories of your father too. Maybe he grew tired of missing you and came around a little. If life has been kind, maybe you took your girlfriend home to Moorhead, Minnesota for a visit last winter, and your parents cooked a roast and put out the good tablecloth and the new silverware. Maybe you and your dad lit a big fire after dinner and you all sat around it together, just talking, storytellers. We can't help but keep hoping that there might just be a happier ending in there somewhere. Please say hi to Winnipeg for me. With much love, Ivan.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you for that reading and everything. Yeah, it's so... Yeah. Thanks for that, too. That was really beautiful. I wanted to ask you, have you heard back from the people that you wrote back to?
Yeah, I've several times from several of them. Actually, Angela wrote to me back. She, I don't want to get the details wrong, I didn't brush up on them, but she did reconnect with her father when her mom passed away, I believe. Yeah, I've heard back from many of them. Some of them I've met now, and I'm hoping to meet more of them. You know, what we did was forge like a forever connection via the publication of these letters, and everybody got paid. I got some money from the Canada Council and Penguin Random, or Mallet and Stewart. They they coughed up some money too. So every letter writer got paid, except for S, the anonymous one. I'm still waiting, hoping that S will. I've got $350 sitting there waiting and two free copies, hardcover. Of the book when S finally hopefully contacts me. That's that was in Victoria. They left a note under the windshield of my car, an anonymous note in two colors of blue ink. And I just heard from Ace I got a text from Ace just a couple of weeks ago. So I have these weird the father and trans son team from Edmonton. Next time I'm in Edmonton, I'm actually going to go for dinner with their whole family. Wow. So yeah, it's been a journey, a really beautiful journey, this book.
This is not a question and you don't need to reply, but I think reading through it again, as I didn't ever read it sort of all the way through ever in one sitting, because I went to your book when I needed it. And when I needed family, I found family in this book. And I want to say a personal thank you. I know I'm not the only one who has felt that way, and all the beautiful comments that have come in from people who attended. Thank you for sharing your great gift, so many of them, with us. You're fucking awesome.
Sorry, you
should. Oh, sorry, I should have warned people that I was going to say that. But.
Content summary. Yep. I wanted to say also, I will light a candle for your mom tonight.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That's super kind. And I want to meet your dad, and I'm going to tell him who I am.
he's really struggling. He's still at that terrible phase of dementia where he knows he doesn't know he doesn't remember anything, you know. Every once in a while he just comes up with the funniest line though.
There's poetry, right? My mother the other day just said, "Time flies, but you can't time flees." Wow, yeah, you really can't. It's just lovely. I don't know where it came from, but thank you again.
I said a kind of a teasing joke to him a couple of last visits I had before I left this fall, and I said, "You know, I'm just teasing, right? Like, you know, I hope I didn't upset you." And he goes, "You know, it's one thing about dementia. It's really hard to hold a grudge."
That's great. Ivan, I'm going to thank you on behalf of everyone attending, and I see that Carleen Thomas stayed with us the whole time.
Unbelievable.
That's such an honor. Pardon the swear words, and I think I'm going to see you again on Friday, Elder Carleen, and I'll try not to F-bomb you, okay? But thank you. And
thank you, Sheila.
It was a real joy. I believe I'm turning things over to Sarah.
Thanks, Sarah.
Or to Kendra. Hi, Kendra. Thank you for everything.
Hello. Thank you so much. So hard to come in at the end after, you know, this emotional ending that you two have left things with, but I'll jump in anyway. Yep. Cry every day. And that is so much more true since the pandemic. My name's Kendra Sakamoto. I'm one of the librarians from West Vancouver Memorial Library. And thank you so much on behalf of all the North Shore libraries to Ivan and to Sheila, to Carleen for that beautiful welcome. This was absolutely amazing. I'm so grateful that I got to be part of it. I'm so grateful to the three of you for just making this evening so unbelievably amazing. Thank you everyone for coming tonight. If you haven't read Care Of, all three libraries have full book club sets. If you have read it and you want it for your book club, come and grab it. Also, you know, buy a copy at your support your local bookstore. We've got lots of them across the North Shore and wherever you live. So please read it if you haven't reread it. I listened to the audiobook version, which Ivan narrates themselves, and it's amazing. So even if you read it, I recommend going back and listening to the audiobook. It's a totally different experience. You really get that performance element, and it's just so moving. And again, thank you so much to everyone for coming tonight, and to Ivan and Sheila, and again, Carleen. I'm so grateful to all of you, and I wish you all a really wonderful and peaceful and happy evening.
Thanks, Kendra. Thanks, Sarah. Sheila, I just love you.
Love you too. And thank
can't
you.
Wait for that hug.
Me too. Kendra and Sarah, Elder Carleen. Hajka. Hi, Sepka. Siam.
Thank you, Elder Carleen.
Thank you all so much. Have a wonderful evening.
Take care, everyone. Stay safe.
Yeah, be well.